You're listening to the CyberWire Network, powered by N2K.
Identity architects and engineers, modernize your identity systems with Strata. Integrate legacy apps with any IDP, ensure seamless identity failover, and apply MFA without touching app code. Strata offers robust, efficient identity management, reducing tech debt and enhancing security. Gain peace of mind and operational efficiency with Strata's comprehensive solutions. Visit strata.io/cyberwire, share your biggest identity challenge, and enjoy free AirPods Pro. Optimize your identity solutions today. Visit strata.io/cyberwire. And our thanks to Strata for being a longtime friend and supporter of this podcast. Stargazer Goblin hosts malicious code repositories on GitHub. CrowdStrike blames buggy validation checks for last week's major incident. The Breach Forum's database reveals threat actor OPSEC. Windows Hello for Business was found vulnerable to downgrade attacks. A medical center in the U.S. Virgin Islands is hit with ransomware. InterIsle analyzes the phishing landscape. The FTC orders 8 companies to explain algorithmic pricing. Meta cracks down on the Nigerian Yahoo boys. A fake IT worker gets caught in the act. My conversation with Nick Fillingham and Wendy Zanoni, co-hosts of Microsoft Security's The Blue Hat Podcast. And researchers wonder if proving you're human proves profitable for Google. It's Wednesday, July 24th, 2024. I'm Dave Bittner, and this is your CyberWire Intel Briefing. Thank you for once again joining us. It is great, as always, to have you here with us. A secret network of around 3,000 ghost accounts on GitHub has been manipulating the platform to promote malware and phishing links, as revealed by research from cybersecurity firm Checkpoint. Operating since at least June of last year, a cybercriminal group dubbed Stargazer Goblin by Checkpoint has been hosting malicious code repositories on GitHub, the world's largest open-source code site. Antonis Terofos, a malware reverse engineer at Checkpoint, discovered that these fake accounts star, fork, and watch malicious repositories to make them appear popular and legitimate. This tactic leverages GitHub's community tools to boost the visibility and credibility of harmful pages. The network's activities are coordinated through a cybercrime-linked Telegram channel and criminal marketplaces. The Stargazer's ghost network spreads malicious repositories offering fake downloads for social media, gaming, and cryptocurrency tools targeting Windows users. They claim to provide tools like VPNs or licensed software, but instead deliver malware. The operator behind this network charges other hackers to distribute their malicious content, a service Checkpoint terms distribution as a service. GitHub has responded by disabling user accounts violating their policies against supporting unlawful activities. With over 100 million users and 420 million repositories, GitHub continues to face challenges from cybercriminals exploiting its platform for malicious purposes. CrowdStrike has released a post-incident review addressing a faulty update that caused 8.5 million Windows machines to crash last week. The issue stemmed from a bug in their test software, which failed to validate a content update correctly. This update was intended to gather telemetry on new threat techniques, but led to system crashes. CrowdStrike's Falcon software, used globally for malware and security management, typically issues two types of updates: sensor content and rapid response content. The problem arose from a 40-kilobyte rapid response content file, which, despite passing faulty validation checks, contained problematic data that led to Windows crashes. To prevent future incidents, CrowdStrike is enhancing its testing process for rapid response content with local developer testing, content update and rollback testing, stress testing, fuzzing, and fault injection. They will also update their cloud-based content validator and improve error handling in the Falcon sensor. Additionally, CrowdStrike will adopt a staggered deployment strategy for updates to avoid widespread issues. The entire database for the notorious Breach Forum's V1 hacking forum was leaked on Telegram, exposing member information, private messages, cryptocurrency addresses, and all forum posts. This database originated from a backup allegedly sold by Connor Fitzpatrick, also known as Pom Pom Purin, after the FBI seized Breach Forums following Fitzpatrick's arrest. The data circulated among threat actors, with one trying to sell it for $150,000. Initially, only limited member data was leaked by a user named Emo. However, due to ongoing infighting within the Breach Forums community, Emo released the complete database, containing records up to November 29th of 2022. This leak reveals extensive details, including hashed passwords and private communications about exploits and stolen data. Law enforcement already possessed this database, but its public release allows researchers and journalists to assess threat actors' operational security practices. Microsoft's Windows Hello for Business, WHFB, was recently found vulnerable to downgrade attacks, allowing threat actors to bypass even biometric protections. WHFB, which uses cryptographic keys in a computer's trusted platform module with biometric or PIN verification, can be exploited by modifying authentication request parameters. Accenture security researcher Yehuda Smirnoff discovered this flaw last year and reported it to Microsoft, which has since issued a fix. Smirnoff will demonstrate the attack and mitigation strategies at Black Hat USA 2024. The attack involves intercepting and altering post requests to Microsoft's authentication services, downgrading WHFB to less secure methods using the Evil Jinx framework. Microsoft's recent update includes a conditional access capability called Authentication Strength to enforce phishing-resistant authentication, preventing such downgrades. This fix ensures only secure authentication methods are used, protecting against similar future attacks. Schneider Regional Medical Center in St. Thomas, U.S. Virgin Islands, experienced a ransomware attack on July 21st, disrupting network systems. IT staff detected the attack, which has led to significant operational challenges, including the unavailability of the patient portal and medical records. While all patient care services continue, the hospital is working with law enforcement and third-party vendors to assess and restore system functionality. The extent of data compromise is still under investigation. InterIsle's fourth annual phishing landscape study highlights the evolving spectrum of phishing attacks from May 2023 through April 2024, emphasizing the persistent and growing threat of cybercrime. The study reveals a significant increase in phishing incidents, with attackers increasingly exploiting subdomain providers and decentralized platforms like the Interplanetary File System to launch their schemes. Following the shutdown of the notorious Freenom service, cybercriminals have turned to inexpensive domains in new GTLDs, demonstrating their adaptability. This shift underscores the need for vigilant domain registration policies, as bulk registrations have become a common tactic for setting up phishing sites. U.S.-based hosting providers continue to be favored by phishers, highlighting the global nature of the threat and the need for international cooperation. The report stresses that effective phishing mitigation requires robust digital identity verification, automated screening systems, and proactive measures by hosting operators. InterIsle recommends cross-industry collaboration and stronger governmental roles to combat phishing. By adopting these measures, the report suggests that the industry can disrupt the phishing supply chain and protect users more effectively. The Federal Trade Commission has issued orders to 8 companies offering surveillance pricing products and services that use consumer data to determine prices. These orders aim to understand the impact on privacy, competition, and consumer protection. The FTC is investigating how third-party intermediaries use advanced algorithms, AI, and personal information, such as location, demographics, credit history, and browsing history, to set targeted prices. FTC Chair Lina Khan expressed concerns about privacy risks and potential price exploitation through personal data. The FTC seeks detailed information from MasterCard, Revionix, Bloomreach, JPMorgan Chase, Task Software, Pros, Accenture, and McKinsey & Company. The inquiry focuses on the types of surveillance pricing products and their uses, data sources and collection methods, customer information and intended uses of products, and the impact on consumers and pricing. The commission unanimously approved the orders. Meta has banned 63,000 accounts linked to Nigerian cybercriminals known as the Yahoo Boys, who targeted users in the U.S. with sextortion scams. These scammers, primarily targeting adult men, coerced victims into sharing explicit images, then threatened to release them unless paid in gift cards, mobile payments, wire transfers, or cryptocurrency. Some attempts targeted minors, reported to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. Meta's crackdown follows FBI warnings about the growing threat of financial extortion targeting children. A smaller network of 2,500 accounts linked to 20 individuals in Nigeria was also uncovered. These scammers used fake accounts and shared resources for scamming, including scripts and guides. Meta designated the Yahoo Boys as a banned entity under its strict dangerous organizations and individuals policy. The company says they're improving detection tactics and sharing information with other tech companies through the Tech Coalition's Lantern program. At security awareness firm KnowBefore, the search for a new software engineer for their IT AI team seemed to go smoothly. They posted the job, received resumes, conducted interviews, performed background checks, and verified references. Finally, they hired someone who appeared to be an ideal candidate. The new hire was sent a Mac workstation, but as soon as it was received, malware began to load. KnowBefore's HR team had conducted 4 video interviews with the candidate, confirming their identity through the provided photo. The background check came back clear, but the individual was using a stolen, valid U.S.-based identity. The photo was AI-enhanced, making it difficult to detect the deception. The EDR software detected the malware and alerted the InfoSec Security Operations Center. When the SOC contacted the new hire, things quickly became suspicious. The employee claimed they were troubleshooting a router issue, but their responses were evasive, and soon they became unresponsive. The SOC team contained the device. Further investigation revealed a sophisticated scam. The fake worker was part of a North Korean operation, using an address as an IT mule laptop farm and VPNs to mask their true location. They worked U.S. hours while being based in North Korea or China, earning money that funded illegal programs. KnowBefore's controls had caught the breach, but it was a stark lesson. They needed to re-examine their vetting process, remote device scans and monitoring, enhanced security measures, and improved coordination between HR, IT, and security teams were vital to protect against such advanced threats. The incident underscored the critical need for vigilance and robust security protocols in the hiring process. Coming up after the break, my conversation with Nick Fillingham and Wendy Zanoni, co-hosts of Microsoft Security's The Blue Hat Podcast. Stay with us. And now, a word from our sponsor, KnowBefore. It's all connected, and we're not talking conspiracy theories. When it comes to InfoSec tools, effective integrations can make or break your security stack. The same should be true for security awareness training. Know Before, provider of the world's largest library of security awareness training, provides a way to integrate your existing security stack tools to help you strengthen your organization's security culture. Know Before's Security Coach uses standard APIs to quickly and easily integrate with your existing security products from vendors like Microsoft, CrowdStrike, and Cisco. 35 vendor integrations and counting. Security Coach analyzes your security stack alerts to identify events related to any risky security behavior from your users. Use this information to set up real-time coaching campaigns targeting risky users based on those events from your network, endpoint, identity, or web security vendors. Then coach your users at the moment the risky behavior occurs with contextual security tips delivered via Microsoft Teams, Slack, or email. Learn more at knowbefore.com/securitycoach. That's knowbefore.com/securitycoach. And we thank Know Before for sponsoring our show. When it comes to ensuring your company has top-notch security practices, things can get complicated fast. Vanta automates compliance for SOC 2, ISO 27001, HIPAA, and more, saving you time and money. With Vanta, you can streamline security reviews by automating questionnaires and demonstrating your security posture with a customer-facing trust center. Over 7,000 global companies like Atlassian, Flow Health, and Quora use Vanta to manage risk and prove security in real time. Our listeners can claim a special offer of $1,000 off Vanta at vanta.com/cyber. That's vanta.com/cyber for $1,000 off Vanta. It is my pleasure to welcome to the show Nick Fillingham and Wendy Zanoni. They are the co-hosts of Microsoft Security's The Blue Hat Podcast, which we are pleased to say has come back to our CyberWire network. Before we dig into some of the details about the Blue Hat Podcast itself, I'd love to get a little bit of background from each of you and kind of what brought you to this podcast and your careers there at Microsoft. Wendy, you want to start things off for us?
Sure. I have had a pretty unique path into security. I quit my job in my 30s and went to software engineering school and then just progressed from there. I was the first graduate to want to focus on cybersecurity, which was really interesting. It kind of paved the way for that school, which I'd seen a lot of people come out of there from cybersecurity. And I went and moved forth and worked at Netflix and Salesforce, and then found myself here at Microsoft. And I've done everything from product security to application security. And now I focus on security, the internal awareness and training aspect of Strike, which is an internal program here at Microsoft.
And Nick, how about you?
Yeah, thanks, Dave. So I've been at Microsoft for, two decades, bouncing around doing a bunch of fun things. I'm like Wendy, I'm in the MSRC, the Microsoft Security Response Center. And I have the privilege, really, of working with the security researcher community. That's hackers and folks out there that are intentionally breaking stuff in with the goal of fixing it and obviously making people safer. And really, I'm not a security researcher. I'm not a security engineer. My background isn't technical, but I like to say that I can ask good questions. And I like to go down little rabbit holes. And so, what I really love about this space is just getting to talk to really, really smart people, really, really curious people, and people that constantly surprise me with how they sort of think outside the box and do interesting and unique things to essentially make the world a safer place, which I know sounds like sort of hyperbolic, but it really True. Is. And so one of the things about I love about working for Microsoft and then also, you know, working on the Blue Hat Podcast.
Yeah, it sounds like you and I are kindred spirits when it comes to that. You know, I always say my favorite part about my job is being able to talk to smart people about interesting things. Can you tell us about the Blue Hat podcast itself? What's kind of the origin story there? Nick, you want to tell us where did it come from?
Absolutely. So Blue Hat is the name of Microsoft's security research conference, which started back in 2005. And so if you are a security researcher or a hacker, you may have heard of Blue Hat or the Blue Hat Conference. It's, you know, been around for almost 20 years. We're going to have the 23rd edition of the conference this year, October 29th and 30th in Redmond, Washington. And basically, initially, Blue Hat was where Microsoft's sort of burgeoning, nascent security division, actually, I don't even know if a security division was there at the time. It was folks that were interested in thinking about security. They brought in some of the top presenters at Black Hat and DEF CON and other sort of existing security research conferences. And they brought them into Microsoft, and they brought all these security-focused folks at Microsoft into a big room. And they had these people present sort of a reality check, sort of a current state of what is happening in this new burgeoning field of security, and what does this sort of external perspective on security and security research look like, what is sort of that reality for Microsoft. And it was successful, and it continued year on year. And as I said, we're coming up to the 23rd edition of the conference, which will be later October in this year. And so the Blue Hat podcast is really an extension of that. We've been going for about 2 years now. This is, I think, this episode or the next episode that folks will listen to is about episode 32, 33, depending on timing. And we bring a lot of those same perspectives and same voices to the podcast. So it's really, it's a focus on security research and security researchers. And we try and bring in both external non-Microsoft people that are in this space, as well as Microsoft people who are either researchers themselves or who are responsible for essentially working with researchers and the research community to implement their findings and make things better. So we really try and show sort of both sides of the story and, you know, both sides of the coin. And it's amazing that, as I said, there's almost sort of 20 years of history here. And so we're constantly bringing people on the podcast who have presented at Blue Hat maybe multiple times spanning almost two decades, and seeing how their respective careers and research focuses have changed over that time, and then the value and the impact that they've had really sort of behind the scenes. Security researchers often, as you know, Dave, they're not household names, but they're doing all this work that is keeping, you know, thousands, if not millions of people safe, protecting the technology that powers pretty much everything that we do every day. So it's a great podcast, it's a great focus. And yeah, we're really bringing forward, you know, as I said, almost two decades worth of work in focusing on the security research community and the security researcher.
Wendy, can you give us a little taste of what folks can expect from the show? What are some of the topics that you've particularly enjoyed, or maybe some of the highlights of the guests that you've had on the show?
Oh, man. I have a shorter time span. I've only been at Microsoft for coming up on 3 years. So compared to some of these other folks, I am so new. And the company is so big and impactful that what I love about participating in this podcast is I get to meet all these folks that help, you know, secure the world. And there's so many people, like Nick was saying, that they're not at the forefront, you know, where everyone knows them as household names. So, you know, even folks such as, I love the episode that we had with Tom Gallagher. He's been at Microsoft for 25 years, but he has such an interesting origin story. You know, he got into security before, you know, there was, you can go to college and major in it. You know, he was one of the pioneers in that sense. And so some of those stories are really interesting. And folks like Sean Hernan, who's been in security for three decades, and you can see, you know, how he really is promoting, you know, fostering a growth mindset in security and how we can, you know, potentially improve the industry going forward. One of the episodes I really enjoyed was with Cameron Vincent, because Cameron was a researcher and he was able to discuss with us what it's like to be a researcher. But then on the flip side, now he's a Microsoft security researcher. So he's seen both sides. And these are areas that I, on, you know, in my everyday, don't get to hear some of these stories. So I love bringing those stories and those facts to the forefront for the audience, but also for myself, because it helps everyone understand that there's so much and so many details, and cybersecurity is so complex and it's always evolving. And so we have this cornucopia of guests that helps secure, because it takes all sorts. And, you know, so it's an interesting thing for me, but I love passing that off to the audience. And then we also ask some fun questions, like, what do you do when you're not, you know, being a security researcher? And it's fun to hear some of those, like, what, who are they outside of this? When some people just, that's all they do and that's their passion. So it's great to just talk to these folks and just hear their stories.
Yeah. One of the things that I really enjoy about the Blue Hat Podcast is that there is something for everyone, no matter where they are in their professional journey in cybersecurity. You could be somebody who's aspirational, a student who's looking to just learn everything, or somebody who's been around in the industry for decades and enjoys hearing, you know, someone else tell some of these tales that you know, that you've heard around the campfire, as it were. There really is something for everybody there.
I agree. And as someone that has transitioned later into the security space, I like hearing the different paths to get there. And then hearing the folks that have been there, as you said, you know, since the beginning, you know, what are their lessons learned? What have they seen over the time? You know, what are their stories? And it is really impactful depending, you know, it doesn't matter where you are in your career. And we do like to ask the question of, what is your advice for folks just starting out? Because as I said, this is an evolving space. We need people to continue to join the industry. And those tips that they give are really, really helpful.
So, Nick, how would you describe your target audience here? Who are you really focused on?
Absolutely. So I think first and foremost, if you are a listener of podcasts across the CyberWire network and you're familiar with Research Saturday, Dave, your podcast, that is someone who I think would really enjoy the Blue Hat Podcast. We talk to researchers. We ask them to talk about their research. What did they find? How did they find the vulnerability or the thing that they discovered, and sort of what's the takeaway. We also ask them for sort of career advice and researching advice too, for folks that might want to enter into this industry or begin to do security research themselves. The other thing we do on the Blue Hat Podcast, which I think is maybe a little bit unique, is because we are inside Microsoft and MSRC, we can sort of add a little bit of a perspective or provide some information with respect to, you know, okay, so what happens once that research is actually submitted? If it's from an external researcher to Microsoft, what does that look like? What does that process look like? And we can help demystify and break that down. And so I think if you are a researcher, you can get some information out of that that can certainly be helpful in understanding the process. And then finally, you know, Wendy has a formal security background, but I don't. I'm just a person that asks questions. And so one of the things I try and do is help extract for the listener, okay, so what does this mean if you're not a security researcher? Maybe you're a security practitioner, maybe you're an IT pro, maybe you're just a small business owner or someone that's just interested in staying secure. How can you take some learnings from maybe some very, very technical and detailed and esoteric security research and actually apply that to everyday life, whether it's life online or life in person? So we really do try and create takeaways for multiple different audiences. So I'd say if you love Research Saturday, we hope you'll love the Blue Hat Podcast. If you listen to CyberWire Daily or anything really across the CyberWire network, we hope we've got something for you on the Blue Hat Podcast, but very much focused on security researchers, the security research community, and then showing sort of both sides of the story from both Microsoft's perspective and then also from the researcher.
Yeah. Well, Nick Fillingham and Wendy Zanoni are the co-hosts of Microsoft Security's The Blue Hat Podcast, which you can find right here on the N2K CyberWire network and wherever you get your favorite podcasts. Nick and Wendy, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Happy to be back.
Enterprises today are using hundreds of SaaS apps. Are you reaping their productivity and innovation benefits, or are you lost in the sprawl? Enter Savvy Security, They help you surface every SaaS app, identity, and risk, so you can shine a light on shadow IT and risky identities. Savvy monitors your entire SaaS attack surface to help you efficiently eliminate toxic risk combinations and prevent attacks. So go on, get savvy about SaaS and harness the productivity benefits. Fuel innovation while closing security gaps. Visit savvy.security to learn more. And finally, Google's reCAPTCHA. You know, those annoying prove you're human puzzles where you have to click on all the images showing traffic lights. Might be more about making money than securing websites, according to some University of California, Irvine researchers. They argue it's actually a sneaky way to harvest your data and make billions from your unpaid labor. Originally, CAPTCHAs were supposed to tell humans and bots apart with tricky puzzles. But now, AI can solve them almost as well as we can. Google's reCAPTCHA, which they acquired in 2009, has evolved, but the researchers say its usefulness is questionable. They found that these puzzles are not just annoying, but also time-consuming and resource-heavy, all while being vulnerable to bots. Apparently, bots were already beating these challenges as far back as 2016, but Google stuck with them, possibly to gather data for other uses. The academics claim that in 13 years, we've spent 819 million hours on reCAPTCHA, worth about $6.1 billion in wages. Meanwhile, they say Google profits from the data we unwittingly provide. The researchers suggest it's time to ditch these CAPTCHAs. They see them as a massive waste of human effort with little real security benefit. Instead of making the internet safer, they say, we've been tricked into doing free labor for Google. A Google spokesperson told the Register that reCAPTCHA user data is solely used to improve the reCAPTCHA service, as stated in their terms of service. Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got to train an AI on how to identify crosswalks. And that's the CyberWire. For links to all of today's stories, check out our daily briefing at thecyberwire.com. We'd love to know what you think of this podcast. Your feedback ensures we deliver the insights that keep you a step ahead in the rapidly changing world of cybersecurity. If you like our show, please share a rating and review in your podcast app. Please also fill out the survey in the show notes or send an email to cyberwire@n2k.com. We're privileged that N2K CyberWire is part of the daily routine of the most influential leaders and operators in the public and private sector, from the Fortune 500 to many of the world's preeminent intelligence and law enforcement agencies. N2K makes it easy for companies to optimize your biggest investment, your people. We make you smarter about your teams while making your teams smarter. Learn how at n2k.com. This episode was produced by Liz Stokes. Our mixer is Trey Hester, with original music and sound design by Elliot Peltzman. Our executive producer is Jennifer Iben. Our executive editor is Brandon Karp. Simone Petrella is our president. Peter Kilpie is our publisher. And I'm Dave Bittner. Thanks for listening. We'll see you back here tomorrow. Most of our listeners who deal with legacy privileged access management products know they tend to be expensive, difficult to deploy, and hard to use. Keeper Security is the answer. Keeper's Zero Trust solution delivers password, secrets, and connection management in one easy-to-use platform. It's fast to deploy, agentless, clientless, and has no implementation fees. Plus, Keeper is FedRAMP authorized. That's why we trust Keeper to prevent breaches and gain full control over privileged users. Visit keeper.io/cyberwire to schedule a quick demo. That's keeper.io/cyberwire. And thanks to Keeper Security for supporting our podcast.